Are you skeptical about neurofeedback for ADHD? I'm Dr. Trish Leigh, and if I had a dollar for every time someone told me I'm a skeptic when I met them, I would be a rich woman. So I am here to share with you the skepticism behind neurofeedback and why it's not necessary. This is based on a study that suggested that there's so much skepticism around neurofeedback, especially when it comes to ADHD, where there really aren't any other treatment options that can address the underlying issue and provide long-term solution. So for ADHD, the primary treatment method is a pharmaceutical approach. It's taking a medicine. So that medicine is designed to offset ADHD symptoms for the time that the medicine is in your body. But then when the medicine is not in your body anymore, the underlying mechanism of ADHD is still there. And so the person will struggle with the symptoms that they don't want. So I want you to understand what the underlying mechanism is and how it can be addressed through neurofeedback. And in doing so, skepticism should decrease. Now, the reason I say that if I had a dollar for every time I heard someone was a skeptic, many times people will join my professional neurofeedback coaching program as a skeptic. And they'll do it because they're really hopeful that neurofeedback will work for them, but at the same time, they don't want to put too many eggs in that basket because they don't understand it. They can understand the idea. I put a pill in my mouth, I feel better for a little while. Those skeptics, after working with me, were skeptics no longer. So I am hoping to provide that for you here in an educational video so that if you're inspired to have neurofeedback in your life, you understand how it works, so you can maybe go in a little skeptical, but more hopeful, and it's pragmatic hope. Pragmatic hope means you know you're doing something that will address that underlying issue. All right, well, without further ado, let's talk about what is the underlying mechanism of ADHD. We know from a whole body of literature that ADHD is caused by a brain that is using too much slow processing speed. It is called theta. Theta speed is slow processing speed. Simultaneously, the brain may be using too little of faster processing speed called low beta. So there's something called TBR, theta to beta ratio. Theta is slow processing, beta is fast processing. So in an optimized, a healthy optimized brain, that theta to beta ratio is small. It's very close together. Slow processing is close to fast processing. But in a brain that has ADHD, that ratio or that gap is wider. It can be one level too wide. It can be two levels too wide. It can be three plus levels too wide. The wider the gap between slow and fast processing, the more challenges a person will have in terms of attending, focus, executive function, organization, and not procrastinating, being able to do things in a timely fashion. The wider the gap may also lead to hyperactive behaviors to offset the fact that there's too much slowness and not enough fastness. If you don't have enough fast speed and you have too much slow speed, your brain feels a constant need for stimulation, or it can't stay alert enough to perform. An analogy that I like to use is I think of theta as braking in the brain. You only want to put the slow brakes on when it's time to fall asleep. I think of low beta as gassing in the brain. You want to be able to put your foot on the gas of your brain at 45 miles per hour, the perfect speed to get around town. Now, when that gap is small between theta and beta, your brakes are not on and your gas is at 45 miles per hour. But the bigger the gap gets, it means your braking is on while your gassing is low. So if you just think about it, it's time to drive around town, but you have your foot on the brake and you just took your foot off the gas a bit, it becomes difficult to get around town like you want to. That's how theta and beta create ADHD symptoms. And those symptoms can really be a struggle for people. If you struggle with ADHD across your whole life, it can impact your academic outcomes, your social life, your ability to be on purpose and to do the things that you want to. It can give you low self-esteem. All of these things are shown scientifically. So this is why I want you to understand the role that neurofeedback plays. What neurofeedback does is it teaches your brain to make less theta. It teaches your brain to make more beta. It closes the theta to beta ratio gap all naturally. It doesn't put anything into your brain. It uses something called operant conditioning. Operant conditioning is a way that your brain can learn based upon auditory and visual feedback of its own performance pattern. So basically, if your theta to beta ratio is close, you will receive a bright screen and loud audio when you're watching a video. I know it seems silly, which makes you skeptical, but it totally works. So you're watching a video, your theta to beta ratio gap closes, your screen plays bright, your audio plays loud. It's reinforcement, positive reinforcement for the brain performance pattern that we want you to use more and more often so you can focus, you can perform and feel great. Now, if your theta to beta ratio spreads and the gap becomes bigger, what happens is the screen goes dimmer and the audio goes lower. It's lack of reinforcement because you're not using the optimal brain performance pattern to achieve your goals. So with time, and I offer a 4-month program, so it's not years, with time and reinforcing, working your brain out through neurofeedback brain training, that's why I call it brain training, you're training your brain to perform closer and closer to the optimal pattern. Now, the cool thing about neurofeedback is you don't even have to get all the way there to feel better. If you have a 3+ level gap and you bring that closer to 2 to 1.5, you start feeling and performing better almost right away. And so from there, the flywheel continues, and all the research behind neurofeedback shows after your program, if we get that positive feedback loop going, your brain will continue to get stronger long term. What that means is you'll no longer have the brain performance pattern of ADHD, and you'll no longer have the symptoms. Now, if you want to know if your brain pattern has a theta to beta ratio gap, that can be visualized and seen on an assessment called a quantitative electroencephalogram. EEG has been around for over 100 years. The qEEG shows the visualization of too much theta, not enough beta. You can see it with your own eyes if you have the ADHD brain pattern, and you also can see which areas of your brain are impacted. Is it one? Is it all of them? And you also can see if it's 1 level, 2 level, or 3+ levels of the ADHD pattern. From there, you can make your decision if neurofeedback's right for you. But I want you to know that there's studies that show that qEEG is the future of diagnosing these types of issues, and neurofeedback, a neuromodulation technique, is the future of solving them. All right, if you want more information, please go over to drtrishleigh.com, check out the ADHD page, and as always, control your brain or it'll control you.